Hello, the internet. I've been building this analog synth rack for the last couple of years, and now that it's finally finished, there's only one thing left to do. Make another one. To put the finishing touches on my new synthesizer rack, I'm going to be showing off some practical 3D prints that are useful in a project like this one, or any home studio, rig, or computer setup that requires a lot of cable management. These are all my own designs, and there will be links to the STL files in the description. Number 1. The cable management clip. I have a zillion of these things around my studio, and I've found them super useful for keeping wires going where they're supposed to go and relieving strain on potentially fragile connections. I plan on using at least 4 of these in this synth rack to make sure the internal power connections are secure and to keep the main power cable in place for transportation. These clips are meant to print on edge, like this, so the print flexes along the layers rather than across them. I recommend printing this in PETG on a 0.8mm nozzle with an extrusion width set to 1.2 times the nozzle size, which seems to be a great sweet spot for nice solid traces. This model's walls are at a size that allows for 2 parallel traces at that width, so you get a nice strong print that uses very little material and has just enough flex. Print with the tallest layers you can, and they'll go pretty fast, probably under 30 minutes each. Number 2, the patch cable holder. These bad boys are nice for holding patch cables on a modular synth, and I like to mount one upside down on the side near the main power cable so you can conveniently wind the cable up. I go 0.8mm in PETG for these as well. Print as grainy as you like and introduce a split process for this little crotch part, so you can crank the layer height down to 0.1, and then you end up with this instead of this. It also helps to add a little more cooling there and put on 5 or so top layers for that process. You can crank one of these out in about an hour and 45 minutes if you go fast. Number 3, the knobs. I love these knobs, and I've printed over 100 of them. They only fit 6mm split shaft potentiometers, so if you want to use these, make sure you've got the right type of potentiometers. I'll link to a product page in the description. These I print on a 0.4mm nozzle with a 0.1mm layer height, which is plenty enough detail. They slide on firmly with no need for a grub screw, and they have a really nice hand feel that I enjoy. For a little extra visual clarity, I like to decorate mine with a gold Sharpie and a layer of clear coat so it doesn't rub off. I also have a jumbo version for those big knobs that see a lot of action, like filter cutoff. Printing these can be a little time consuming. I usually do about 6 of them in a 4.5 hour print. They'll come out much nicer if you print them in sequence, like this, rather than all at once, much less stringing. Finally, here are a few extra examples of super simple prints that anyone can whip up in a couple of minutes. Cover for a hole saw hole. If you're running a cable through a big hole in a piece of wood, these are nice to smooth things out and make it look more finished. This is literally a circle in a circle with 2 extrusions. You can model it in 2 seconds. Next up, brackets for 2020 extrusion. These aluminum T-slot extrusions are super common for 3D printer builds and other projects. I'm using them for rails on a modular synth. You can make brackets for these in like 2 seconds. It's a couple of squares with a couple extrudes, drill holes where needed, and bam. Last but not least, an enclosure for your power supply. These particular ones I designed for use with the AI Synthesis DIY power supply. Since I'm mentioning them, here's a link in the description. They're good, and they're cheap. But you can do the same thing for whatever power supply and distribution solution you're into. This is really nothing fancy, it just gives you a way to screw them in and keep those big capacitors from getting knocked around by whatever else is clunking around in the case. Quick and dirty. For stuff like these last few examples, good enough is the rule of thumb. Don't overthink it. Whoop, wait, my power conditioner just came in the mail. So even laster but not leaster, let's print some brackets to mount it directly in the case. Each of these Eurorack power supply units is powered by a wall wart, and trying to dangle those wall warts out the side of the case and find a place to plug them in is a hassle. Instead, I'm going to mount this allegedly EMI-reducing, ground-loop-eliminating power conditioner directly in the case. Plug your wall warts in and use the old zip-tie extender trick to tie them down. Now I can plug this whole rack directly into the wall and everything inside is locked down so tight you can turn the whole rack upside down, face down, sideways, or whatever without any of the internals knocking around and damaging those delicate PCBs. I hope you find these examples useful, and feel free to check out the designs on Thingiverse. If you're curious what the synth sounds like, it's been in the backing track this whole time. I plan to do more videos reviewing the modules I'm building since a lot of DIY projects don't really have reviews. Anyway, take care, and thanks for watching.